From WLWT, this is Let's Talk Cincy, presented by Western and Southern Financial Group. Put our financial strength behind you.
Hello, everyone. I'm Curtis Fuller, and welcome to Let's Talk Cincy. Today, a real pleasure to talk to this gentleman. He has been the head of the Ohio Justice and Policy Center for 21 years. He's leaving Cincinnati, but he is not leaving the effort that he has built over the past 20-plus years. And the Ohio Justice and Policy Center will still be there doing great work. Please welcome David Singleton to the program. It's good to see you.
So good to see you, Curtis. Thanks for having me.
Let's talk about Ohio Justice and Policy Center. You've been there 21 years, and as I said to you, you've been the face of this organization for 21 years.
Yeah, well, I could not be more blessed to have had the opportunity to serve OJPC. When I came and started heading it up in 2002, we were known by a different name. It was the Prison Reform Advocacy Center. And our work at the time focused on trying to help incarcerated people, people throughout the state whose civil rights and human rights were violated. But over the years, and as we changed our name, we have taken on other efforts. Mm. So we've got still our Human Rights in Prison project, but we also have work we're doing in communities, mainly in Cincinnati and also Columbus, but soon to be around the state, where we're trying to help people who have criminal records overcome the legal barriers that they face, like from not being able to get a job or to get housing or benefits and things of that nature. That's called our second chance work. Mm. And then we also are doing this work called Beyond Guilt. And that's about trying to free people who are overpunished.
And you started this about 2019 or so.
We sure did, yeah. 2019. Yeah. And we've had some unusual allies in that work, including one, Joseph T. Dieters, before he left to go to the Ohio Supreme Court. We were able to work collaboratively to free people who were serving time for serious things. Now, I'm not talking about a minor drug crime. I'm talking about people who had been in a long time for murder, but they had changed. They had transformed themselves behind bars, and they'd been in for a long time already. And what was the point of keeping them locked up if they could come home and be a productive member of the community? So that work's been going on since 2019. And then we're in the state house all the time trying to get laws changed and partnering with people across the political spectrum to get good work done so that we can make our criminal legal system more just.
I would imagine a lot of people might confuse you with the Innocence Project, but you are not the Innocence Project. You work with them on many cases. Explain to people how you work with that particular program.
If I had a dollar for every time somebody said, oh yeah, you're with the Innocence Project. Yeah, they do amazing work. We are big fans of the Innocence Project, and they're fans of ours too, but we're very different. Our primary focus, I mean, we have represented a handful of innocent people, including Tyra Patterson. Yeah. And I think a lot of people who know Tyra's story, she served 23 years for something she didn't do. She's a force in Cincinnati. She's a force, and beyond Cincinnati. But I think people think, okay, we're the Innocence Project. No, we mostly represent people who have done something wrong, but they're still human beings. They don't deserve, when they're in prison, to be treated worse than a human being. They don't need to be treated like an animal. We represent people who have potential to shine if we don't write them off. That's our motto. We don't write people off. We don't write people off ever. So, yeah, we joke sometimes that we're the guilty project because we represent people who may be guilty, but they're still human beings and they need to be fought for. And that is not a liberal issue. It's not a conservative issue. It's a human issue. And that's something we're real proud about.
I'm going to come back to that because in this day and age where crime is at everyone's front door,
yes,
people want these tough sentences. They want to see people locked up and might get frustrated to hear that people who have committed a crime are now not completing their sentence. Yeah. But hold that thought. We'll come back to that. I want to follow the train with Ohio Justice and Policy Center. You'll be leaving that now, going to Washington, D.C. Talk a little bit about that.
Well, I trailed my wife, Verna Williams, here to Cincinnati. We actually came in 2001. I started at OJPC in 2002. But I trailed her, so she could be a law professor at UC. And now I'm trailing her to D.C. She has been there since September. She stepped down from running UC Law School because she wanted a new challenge, and that challenge was heading up a national nonprofit called Equal Justice Works. So I'm going to be, starting in the fall, a professor at the University of District of Columbia's Law School, but I'm also gonna still do cases. I'm gonna represent people. I'm gonna continue on with about 16 of my cases that I'm currently representing folks, trying to get them out of prison. And I'm gonna look to do more national cases as well. So I'm still gonna be in the fight. I'm gonna be the biggest cheerleader for OJPC there is. I'm not gonna be its leader anymore, but I can cheerlead, and that the work is gonna continue. We're close to announcing who my successor is gonna be, and I will work with that person, whoever it is, to help ensure that the organization continues to thrive.
That's good to hear. We're going to take a break and then come back. And then we'll revisit this issue about sentencing and what's to come. All right, we'll be back in a moment. Welcome back. And with me is David Singleton. He is the longtime director of the Ohio Justice and Policy Center, leaving there now after 21 years, headed to Washington, D.C. He is also a law professor over at NKU. I didn't mention that at the top. So he has stayed very busy in addition to many other things throughout the community. Let's talk a little bit about this whole sentencing. I was saying that, you know, this issue of crime, people say people need to be punished. They want them punished. They want them put away. But your position, I think, is if we put them away, we should have some responsibility in making sure that they are rehabilitated, that we hear that term related to our prison system. Is that a fair assessment?
You are exactly right. We are at OJPC for accountability. People need to be held accountable for the things that they do, particularly when that involves a serious crime, where they've hurt someone, where they've taken a life. Accountability is important. But what we can't do is say we're going to throw the person away forever and not recognize that they're a human being with worth and potential. And I think that's where the disconnect comes in, because, you know, it's tempting to think, okay, somebody who could kill another person is either they're beyond, you know, hope, they're beyond redemption, they just are the worst of the worst. And that may be easy to say from afar, but I get up close with the people that I represent. I get to meet them. I get to see their humanity. And, you know, that is one of the reasons why when Joe Dieters was still prosecutor, you know, he blessed us working to free a number of people who were in for murder. And it was because he understood that there is something called humanity. And he, you know, he and I don't agree about a lot. And he may not be willing to see humanity as freely as I am able to see it and willing to see it, but he still got that point in that once people have been rehabilitated, we ought to be able to give them another chance. So I understand why people may not feel warm and fuzzy about all of the work that we do, or maybe not any of the work that we do, but it's important work because we're talking about human beings at bottom who deserve, and many of them have shown that they deserve the opportunity for a second chance.
When you see these stories about kids, I mean, 15, 16-year-olds committing crimes, either murder or felonious assault or something with guns, You would hope that they are not throwing their complete lives away. And you would hope that you can get to them, rehabilitate them in some form or fashion. As I do these stories, I'm not hopeless yet, but I tell you, it's very disturbing what we see.
It is disturbing what we see, and don't be hopeless ever, though, because once we're hopeless, then we've lost. And I do believe that, and I see it, that people can change. We've gotten a number of people out of prison under a new law that allows people who committed their crimes as minors to get an earlier consideration for release. And in case after case that I've seen folks actually take advantage of the opportunities in prison to change, to get educated, to understand the impact of what they did, and to make better choices when they come out. And so far, we have an excellent track record in terms of people not going back.
When we come back, I'll ask you about you made national news of sorts on this same track. You wrote a column referencing the Ahmaud Arbery case, and we'll talk a little bit about that, but it's on the same line of thought that sometimes we can over-sentence. But let's take a break and we'll continue that thought. Back in a moment. Welcome back. I'm talking to David Singleton. We haven't had a conversation like this in a while, so it's good to have you here. I hate that you're leaving Cincinnati, going to Washington. We'll be a law professor there at the University of Washington, D.C. And we'll still be handling cases, he said, with Ohio justice and policy, not directly, but cases that you've been handling. We're talking about sentencing and over-sentencing. You wrote a column for the Washington Post, and obviously it struck a nerve with people because it took on the case of those convicted in the Ahmaud Arbery case. Talk a little bit about why you did that, the attention that it received, and where do you go from here?
Well, the three men who killed Ahmaud Arbery, let me just say this, that crime was horrible. I was sick to my stomach when I watched the video of it. My biggest fear was that those three white men who killed Mr. Arbery, who is black, were going to get no accountability. They were going to be found not guilty. It was going to be a return to what it felt like probably for people who grew up in the 50s and the 60s. I really worried about that. And I was relieved when the verdict came back that the three men were found guilty. But then when they were sentenced once and then again, and it was like overkill for the sentence. I forget exactly now what the sentences were, but basically it was gonna mean they were never gonna get out. And I wrote about how if you are against over-punishment, generally speaking, because lots of people are talking about mass incarceration and they're saying, you know, we need to not be locking people up for so long, particularly as it affects black and brown people. If you care about that issue, then you should also care about it when we over-punish people who may not fit who you traditionally think about as over-punished, because we can't have a system that says it's okay to overpunish and give someone 300 years because the crime, you know, happened to occur in the South involving a white person killing a black person. Either you're for reducing mass incarceration or you're not. And so I wrote about that. And it wasn't that I was saying those three men need to be freed now. No, they need to be held accountable. But at some point, should they have an opportunity to come into the community again? And I took the position, yes. And let me just say, there were about 4,000 comments to the article. There were some that were supportive of what I said. There were many who, that weren't. My wife and daughter thought, dad and husband, why are you taking that position? But I think it was the principal position. It's a principle I believe in, and it should apply to people who commit crimes that impact me in a particular way. So,
do you see, and thank you for explaining that. I've been wanting to talk to you about that for a while. As you see the current system, I mentioned these kids who now enter the legal system. Are they getting a fair shake as they go through the system, or is it still the color of your skin, how much money you make, those type of things? Does that still have a bearing?
It does, unfortunately, still have a bearing, and here's why it has a bearing. There is bias in our system, and a lot of it is unconscious. I don't think that most people in our judicial system, be it judges, prosecutors, in Ohio and across the country, are consciously racist. But there are implicit bias that every single one of us, you and me included, carry around. So I think that can shape who we think is worthy of a break and who we don't think is worthy of a break. And then money comes into this too, because unfortunately, we don't fund public defenders the way that we should. Now, I'm going to give a shout out to the Hamilton County Public Defender's Office, which has really improved over the years, certainly since I've been here. They've gotten a lot better, and are much more client-centered and have talented, committed people working there. But they're still under-resourced. And across the country, public defenders are under-resourced. And that means in many jurisdictions, lawyers who are meeting their clients for the first time and then talking them into pleading guilty. And sometimes, maybe justice is done, but not when you're rushing people through and processing them through. So I think that is another piece of this. And that impacts, people who are poor, whether they are black, whether they are white, or some other race. So I think we have real problems in our system. And we still need to be working to make sure that it is a just system. And the thing I always ask people to think about is, what sort of system would you want if your loved one was charged with a serious crime? And then people will say sometimes, well, that would never happen. It happens. And who would you want, representing you? Somebody who's well-resourced or somebody who has 300 cases and they can't get to yours in a thoughtful way?
Quick question before we take this final break. How many people have you gotten out of jail? Have you kept count of that?
Yeah, we've gotten 45 out since 2019. Pretty much everybody's was convicted of murder, and a few exceptions to that.
And how are they doing now?
Well, very well. Everybody's doing well. Everybody's doing really well, and I could not be prouder of their track records. They're working, they're neighbors. They're just people's neighbors. And, they vote, they pay their taxes, they go to the grocery store, get food to eat. They're living their lives. They're living their lives.
When we come back, I am going to take you back to the beginning. I want you to tell your story, how you became who you are today.
Okay.
All right. We'll do that in just a moment. I don't say this just simply because he is here. David Singleton is brilliant. And to have him sort of talk about the law in the way that you've been able to do this past half hour, I appreciate it. Take us back. You grew up in North Carolina, but take us back to what made you want to do what you're doing.
Well, first of all, thanks for the kind comment. And so what do I do? What I do? When I was 21 years old, I was in New York that summer on a college internship. And although I grew up in North Carolina, I was born in the South Bronx. I only lived there for 6 months. And I asked my mom to tell me the block we lived on in the South Bronx, because I'd never seen it. And so way before there were cell phones with turn-by-turn directions, I somehow found the block. And I was blown away by what I saw. I still remember the broken glass on the sidewalk shimmering in the sunlight. It's a gorgeous day that day, but this broken glass was everywhere. Boarded up buildings everywhere on the block. And young black men about my age on the corners. And what it looked like was that they were involved in drug dealing. And that was the minute that it hit me that but for an accident of birth, but for being born to the parents I had who said, we need to get out of here, and went down, took me to Asheville, North Carolina, where I was bored as a kid. Asheville was not what it was, what it is now. Yeah. I was bored, but thank God I was bored. Thank God I had good schools. And so that was the moment where I was like, I need to go to law school and help people who I could have been. That's my if you will, origin story in terms of my desire to do the work I do.
Well, you shared some of that, but that's an impressive story. We wish you well as you head off to Washington, D.C. Excited about this new challenge? I mean, this is a different kind of challenge for you, but excited about
it? I'm excited about it. It's bittersweet, though, because my heart is still going to be here in Cincinnati. It's going to be here with the good people who I've met here. I miss living in an area that politically may not always make me feel comfortable, but I get to see that there are good people who maybe I don't agree with politically. I like being out of a bubble here, and I'm going to miss that. I'm going to miss my clients at OJPC, at least the ones that I'm not taking with me. I'm going to miss my staff. I'm going to miss NKU and my colleagues there. So it's bittersweet.
Yeah. Well, in Cincinnati, we'll miss you and your wife. You guys have made a difference, and a lot of times you don't get a chance to hear that. But I think I speak for hundreds, literally thousands of people who would tell you, you've made a significant difference here in Cincinnati. And thank you for joining us here on the show.
Thank you, Curtis.
All right. Well, that's all the time we have today for Let's Talk Cincy. I have enjoyed this conversation, David Singleton. I'll see you next time for another edition of Let's Talk Cincy.